So hi, everyone, and welcome to the Removing CI/CD Blockers webinar. Our panelists for today are Komodor's co-founding CEO, Itiel Schwartz, and our dear friend and neighbor from across the Mediterranean, a developer advocate at Codefresh, the one and only Kostis Kapelonis. We're going to talk about Kubernetes troubleshooting and some CI/CD best practices. And we'll have a quick Q&A session at the end, so feel free to drop your questions below. And Kostis, take it away.
Thank you. So these are your hosts today. I have Itiel with me, who is the co-founder of Komodor. I'm working for Codefresh, which is a CI/CD solution / GitOps. And today, we are going to talk first about like the general problem, which is how you troubleshoot Kubernetes applications. We should talk about why we should not use kubectl. If you like kubectl or kubectl or however you call it, and you think it's the best tool for troubleshooting, it is not. We'll see the best tool today. We will see how you can not replace your metrics. Komodor is not replacing your metrics, but it's something you use along with your existing metrics. So don't fear that we will take away your metrics. We will have a demo. Actually, I think we'll have two demos. So if the demo gods are good, you will see two demos today. And then we'll have a discussion and Q&A. So I think it's important for this particular webinar to give also a short intro on how it started. It's not one of those webinars where, you know, we have Codefresh as a company, Komodor as a company, and they come together and they say, let's have a webinar. No, it didn't happen like this. I discovered Komodor as a user, like as a person, not as a Codefresh employee. I found, I think it via Reddit ad, and I tried it and I thought this is the best thing ever and most people should know about it. So I sat down and I wrote a blog post. If you haven't read it, you can see it here along with the link, which is essentially a review of Komodor and also an introduction to this new family of troubleshooting tools specifically for Kubernetes, which is a new family. I don't think that there is any other tool close to Komodor today, right now in this aspect. So I wrote the article. I don't think it, not many people, you know, paid attention then, but then Komodor announced their funding and everybody said, let's go and read the article. So if you haven't read it, go and read it and see why Komodor is so important. So after this blog post, we said, okay, maybe we should do a webinar so that we can answer questions, show Komodor like in a demo and see how people troubleshoot their own applications and if this is something interesting to them. So why should I care? This is the most basic question on every webinar because I find too many webinars starting with the solutions without explaining the problem. Let's talk about the problem first, why you need to care. And the problem that we are going to talk about today is not Kubernetes specifically. I mean, if you are here, you probably know that everybody is moving to Kubernetes or at least you, trying to go to Kubernetes or adopting Kubernetes in production. And if you look at the ecosystem right now, and there is also the famous landscape from CNCF, which I'm not going to show. We have already several tools for existing aspects of a platform, like how you maintain a platform. If you want to do CI/CD, there are many tools. Codefresh is the best, of course. If you want to do security scans, there are many tools. If you want to do testing, there are many tools and monitoring, that's it. But there are zero tools for troubleshooting applications. Zero. Maybe there are, you know, for other platforms like for virtual machines or for hardware, but not for Kubernetes applications. And when I'm talking to people about troubleshooting, almost always they say, yeah, it's kubectl. So I open a terminal and I start running commands. And what happens is that they play the game of 20 questions. Like something is down and you start and you say, kubectl, get the namespaces. Then you find your pods. Then the logs, then you inspect stuff and it takes too much time. It's not a good tool. And the problem that we are going to talk about today is not how you look at a cluster when you know everything is fine, but like when timing is important. So it's 3 a.m., you were sleeping, you have your pager going off and you need to resolve an issue right now. Is this the perfect opportunity to use kubectl? No. And you will almost certainly have, you know, horror stories where you open kubectl on the wrong terminal. You try to delete something on the wrong cluster and stuff like this. Kubectl is also destructive. Like it's a tool that you can use to both read data and delete data. So if you ask me, it's dangerous. And there is even the whole discussion, which are not, we are not going to analyze today, if you know developers should have kubectl access on the cluster. So you need to make a choice as a company and say, hey, maybe I give my developers and operators kubectl access and I take the risk, or I don't give developers kubectl access, which then means that developers cannot debug stuff if you only have kubectl and nothing else. So it's a lose and lose situation. And even if you don't believe me, you should believe Kelsey Hightower, which is the, let's say, the number one developer advocate in the Kubernetes space. He works for Google. And back in 2018, actually, so not this year, he said that kubectl is the new SSH. When he originally wrote a tweet, I said, okay, I don't understand exactly what he's talking about, but now I do. People abuse kubectl. They think it's the new secure shell for clusters, and they use it for everything. And if you ask somebody that is working with virtual machines, most probably they will have a specific tool for troubleshooting. They will not use kubectl. They will use kubectl as the last resort. Like when everything else has failed, then they will use SSH to go into the virtual machine and see something. And this is how you should do with kubectl. Kubectl is the last resort if nothing else works. There are several solutions before you reach kubectl, and Komodor is obviously the one that we're going to talk about today. So don't use kubectl or SSH for debugging Kubernetes applications. So what is the challenge? What we are trying to solve? The scenario is that we are going to have a problem, an application is down, and we need to debug the issue as fast as possible. Because if the application is down and we are patched, it means that it's something important, the company is losing money, you don't have enough time to look at 5,000 systems. And also ideally, the application that you are paged is something that you are familiar with, so you know how things work. Maybe you have a runbook. Maybe you have seen the same problem again. So you see it, you wake up, and you say, yeah, I have seen this again. You fix it, and you go back to sleep. But this is not always the case. Sometimes you might have to work with unfamiliar clusters that you know, you're not expert on. Or then one of the most classic scenarios is that you are paged for your own application. You spend some time to look at your own application. You see that everything is fine, and then you realize that you need to go one step further and look at other applications from other teams. Maybe you have dependencies and you are not an expert there. So you have essentially two problems that you need solutions. One is to solve the problem itself, but you also have a big problem to understand who is responsible for solving the problem. Maybe you can do it, maybe you cannot do it, and you need to wake up another team. So Komodor is a great fit exactly for this scenario. I'm saying this because maybe you have, you know, another Kubernetes dashboard that if it's your job 9 to 5 and you're sitting on your chair and the cluster is fine and you want a nice dashboard to look at stuff, yeah, there are existing solutions right now, but these are not good for this particular scenario. And usually where there is an incident, no matter the company that you work on, no matter your application, the questions that you need to answer are mostly standard. The first thing is, what was the last change? Because again, if you have worked in a big company, almost always, I would say 80% of the time, 50% of the time, problems with deployment are actually a configuration change. Something went bad, somebody changed something, either officially or not officially, and there was a problem. Of course, there are issues where the human weren't the issue, and there was some other system that had the issue. But in my experience, this is not, let's say, the usual case. So you need to know who made the last change, what was the last change, and sometimes the last change is not passing from your CI/CD system because some people like to change the cluster on their own. You want to find all associated information for the service. So you want to know where are the CI/CD pipelines, where are your metrics, where are your logs. So there are other systems that you need to look. And also you want to know the dependencies because maybe your application works okay, but you're using another application that itself has an issue. So you need to answer these questions as fast as possible. And remember, the time is 3 a.m. You were just sleeping and you don't have, as much time as you want. You need a tool that helps you do this as fast as possible. And when I ask, people, and also from my own experience, how do you actually solve this problem? The answer is complicated. People say, go to my runbook, maybe I look at the wiki for previous issues, maybe I open my logs, maybe I open my metrics. But the truth is that you need to open several systems at once because you don't know in advance where is the answer. So if it's an existing problem that you have faced before, yes, the answer is in the runbook. But if you don't have a runbook or it's a new problem, you cannot use the runbook. Then maybe you want to go to your metrics, and the metrics usually they say that something is wrong, but they don't say why something is wrong. They don't have the reason. So you know that something is down or when you know things happen, but not the actual reason. Of course, you can go to your internal wiki and set stuff. And usually when everything else fails, you go to Slack and you start talking to people and asking, hey, maybe somebody changed something, or who can wake up this person and this person in order to help. So I don't know about you, but this is not my idea of fun. If I'm waking up, I want to go to sleep as fast as possible. So having to look at five different systems without, you know, having like a central hub that connects everything and gives me a full view is my, let's say, dream of debugging Kubernetes applications. So Komodor is exactly this. It helps you solve these two problems, like don't visit five different systems, unless it's absolutely necessary. Start from a single system and, you know, go gradually and drill down to the problem. And also go and find the information that you want and that you have in a self-service manner. So don't wake up people and ask questions like, where are the logs for this application? Where is my CI pipeline for this application? You should have this information at hand. This problem should be solved. So you can only focus on the problem of actually finding the problem. You should have all the information at hand and know where to find that is the problem. This is what we're going, this is what we want. And right now, most Kubernetes tools do not solve this particular issue. So we enter Komodor. What is Komodor? Komodor is a dashboard that is designed exactly for this, solving problems with Kubernetes applications. That's its main focus. You install it very easily on the cluster. It's a small agent. You install it on the cluster, and there is a dashboard. It's the hybrid installation. If you know about it, Codefresh is also working on a similar way in other systems. You install something on your cluster, and then you get access to the dashboard. And you will see all the details in the demo, but the goal of Komodor is to give you all the information that you need at that point in time, as fast as possible, so that you can focus on the problem. So it's a troubleshooting tool. I want to make it clear that it's not a metric solution. It doesn't, you know, take any metrics. It works with metric solutions. It doesn't deploy anything. It works with deployment solutions. It doesn't do anything with networking. It works with networking solutions. So it's something that you install, and it has integration with all the things that you already have in your company. It gets information, it aggregates information for all the system and shows you only what is important for the incident. But it's not a metric solution, because some people might look at the dashboard and say, yeah, this is a metric solution. No, it's not a metric solution. There are actually integrations for things like Datadog and other solutions like this. If you ask me, and this is why I'm so excited for Komodor, Komodor is introducing a new family of tools, like a completely new. It's a family of tools called Kubernetes troubleshooting. And as far as I know, you know, in the chat, you can correct me if I'm wrong, this is the first and only tool in this category. So this is, you know, good and bad, because it means that Komodor is revolutionary and doesn't have any competitor, but also it makes it a bit difficult to describe to people, because, you know, people like to learn about tools along with existing tools. So you say, hey, what is GitHub Actions? It's the same thing as GitLab CI. So you know how GitLab CI works, so you know how GitHub Actions works. But Komodor is not like any existing tool that you have. Maybe it looks like a Kubernetes dashboard, but it's not a Kubernetes dashboard. I mean, like the user Kubernetes dashboard. Maybe it looks like metrics. It's not a metric solution. And I want to make it clear, because I guess in the audience, maybe, you know, we have both developers and operators. Like right now, if you look at the Kubernetes ecosystem, operators are mostly happy. Like most people are developing tools for operators. They have their dashboards, their metrics. They can see what they want. But developers are not so happy. There are not many, you know, solutions specifically for developers. And this is also true, like, for main development. You know, there is a new family of tools for helping developers with local development on Kubernetes. And Komodor, I think, is one solution that is not specifically aimed at one role or the other. You can use it either if you're a developer or an operator, along with your metrics. And especially if you're a developer, one of the problems that, you know, you have with metrics is that metrics are not, let's say, that useful to you. Usually all the metric solutions show too much information for a developer. I mean, as a developer, I don't care about, you know, PVCs or storage or networking. As a developer, I want to know, is my application up? Yes, no. When was the last deployment? That time, what changed? That's it. That's the only thing I want to to know. So if you know, you say you're adopting DevOps and you want developers and operators to work on the same, let's say, level, and you also have the idea of you build it, you run it, you want, you know, developers to also maintain the application and not just, you know, say, hey, take it and this is your problem now, you know, the classic images. I think Komodor is like the embodiment of this idea that you should help everybody and you should give something for everybody so you can keep both developers and operators happy. I think especially developers will be very happy with Komodor. And again, it doesn't replace your metrics. As you will see in the demo, you can get links to your metrics from Komodor. So if you already have metrics in place, Komodor, you know, can take advantage of them and you can go and look at them. But if you want to keep both let's say, developers and operators happy, Komodor is the way to go. So today we're going to look at a demo. I'm going to use Codefresh, but you know, this webinar is not really about Codefresh. If you're not familiar with Codefresh, it's a combination of CI, CD plus GitOps solution. It's three distinct products. The CI product is what you would normally do with pipelines. So it's a pipeline that takes care of your unit tests, your security scans, your integration tests, load testing, and whenever there is a commit, you do something. Then there is a CD part of the platform where you have deployments. You can use either Helm or not Helm or customize, and you have a nice dashboards, again, for developers that show where is the application. And our newest product is for GitOps. We use Argo CD behind the scenes, if you know about Argo CD. And we follow, you know, the GitOps paradigm where everything is passing from Git. I'm mentioning this because today we're going to see like a demo with Codefresh, but Komodor can work with like any CI/CD platform. It doesn't require GitOps. You can, you know, put it on your cluster and it's always independent or your own deployment solution. So I think that's enough for the introductions. We have talked about, you know, the problem. We have talked about the lack of existing tools in the space. We have talked about what Komodor is doing. So time for the demo. And actually, this is the first demo. I will show a very simple example of Komodor, like a real scenario. And then ETL will show a second demo with more advanced stuff. We didn't, you know, want to show everything at once. So let's say, again, it's 3 a.m. I'm sleeping and I'm getting paged and the application is down. Which application? The money maker application. So it's the main application that is making money to the company. It's absolutely critical. I need to solve the problem as fast as possible. So I have opened Komodor here in the application. And this is my focus. And the main thing that Komodor offers is a timeline. You can see the timeline here in the middle of the window. It goes from left to right. You can see the times again. And on the timeline, there are events. And unlike, you know, your CI solution that only knows about your deployments or your metrics that only know about specific things, Komodor monitors your cluster all the time. It also aggregates events from other sources. So it has a superset of all the events. In this example, just to, you know, to keep things easy, this thing, this triangle is a deployment that happened from Codefresh. And you can see that the deployment happened at this point in time, then everything was fine. And then 1 hour and a half later, things went down. So just by seeing this, I even get, you know, my first, let's say, information, piece of information, that the deployment happened and everything was fine and things broke down later. So maybe the deployment is responsible for the problem, maybe it's not responsible. So the first feature I want to show about Komodor is that Komodor allows you to annotate your application with user information. So let's say that I'm not familiar with this application and I want to look at the metrics. I could go to my Grafana dashboard and start, you know, looking, but here with Komodor, I have all the information at hand. So here you can see I have a link which I can click and it takes me to my Grafana metrics for this particular application if I want to see the metrics. This is like, you know, a global annotation, but you can also annotate your application in a dynamic manner. So in this particular deployment, as I click on it, I will show some things about the deployment, but also Komodor has dynamic annotations where you can say which particular CI pipeline made this deployment, which is really, really important. So I have added the annotation here. And now if I want to say, how do you deploy this application? I can simply click on my deployment, scroll down. We are not going to use Jenkins today. We're going to use Codefresh. So I can click on it and I go directly in the pipeline that deployed this application. So now we're in Codefresh. This is, you know, a basic CI pipeline. You can see it has multiple steps. The first one is checking out the code. Then maybe I check my quality, like for Linux errors. I compile the code, maybe I'm running some tests. I build my application, and then finally I deploy. It's all YAML, as you know, most systems. I'm not going to talk too much about Codefresh. I'm just going to highlight that for each particular step, you can use a different Docker image, unlike other systems that I will not name that only force you to use a single image. So for example, for this linting thing, I'm using Golang, like a Golang CI image. For this one, I'm using Golang like the language. And from the drive scan, I'm using the drive. So that's, let's say, the 2 minute intro to Codefresh. We're not going to talk about it today. Also notice that this is through continuous deployment. Like I'm starting from a commit and I go straight to deployment. There are no approval steps or promotions or stuff like that. Even though Codefresh supports this. So the important thing here is that everything looks green. Like as far as Codefresh is concerned, all the tests were passed, all the quality steps were finished, the image was built and pushed successfully, and the deploy has finished. So this reinforces, you know, my feeling that this deployment was not a problem, because as we saw in the dashboard, after the deployment, maybe things were okay until 1 hour and a half. So I go back to Komodor, and the killer feature of Komodor, and I think if you want to keep one thing from this presentation, is that Komodor has this idea of dependent services. And unlike other solutions that are focusing on build time information, Komodor is actually taking this info during runtime. It tracks the dependencies between services as they are in the cluster. And remember, I said before that Komodor is not replacing existing tools. It's taking information from other tools. So Komodor gets this information for other systems. For example, if you have, think Istio, you can get this information for Istio. If you have Datadog, you can get this information for Datadog. So you use an existing system and take only what you want, because this is what matters to you right now. So I'm saying, hey, this application seems to be okay. The deployment seems to be okay, but maybe there is a dependent application that I need to look at. And for this particular demo, I want to make things simple. There isn't an integration, but a very usual scenario is that the applications that are in the same namespace with this application are also dependent. So maybe they're affected. So right now I'm only looking at the MoneyMaker application, but there are two more applications in the same namespace. So I look at the timeline here and I'm focused on a single service, but I can click on other services and put them in the same timeline. This is, for me, one of the most, you know, interesting features of Komodor, that it takes all the services and merges them on a new, let's say, timeline where everything is sorted, and I can see the complete timeline of services. And you can see that so far, Komodor is helping me and answering, you know, all the questions that I need instead of throwing all the information all at once, let's say with a metric solution. First, I look at my application. I'm going to look at a dependent application. So looking at the applications, this simple deployment doesn't seem to be a problem, because as you can see, nothing has happened for this. I mean, there isn't any problem, so I can disregard it. I'm not going to look at it. I'm going to focus on this that I have named for the demo, hidden dependency. And you can instantly see that here we had two deployments. So this looks like first the dependency was deployed and then my application was deployed. And I can look here and see all the details, and I will talk about them. So this also, you know, shows like the granularity of things, that maybe this application needs to be up first and then the second, maybe, I don't know. Here there is another event, and I think it's important to show this. Somebody went and changed the replicas. So the replicas were 2 and now it's 4. And in every let's say event, Komodor is smart and it gives me all the information I need. So here on the top, I can see what was changed in the cluster. So a deployment happened here because I see the Docker image is completely different. But on the lower level, I also have information for GitHub. So I can see also what happened on the application level. So this particular deployment was part of a commit. I can see it here. But if I click on this particular change, somebody changed manually the replicas. There isn't any Git information. Okay, so that doesn't look very good. Maybe he wanted to do something, or she wanted to do something, but the application was still fine. Then there is another change of replicas that's still fine. And here is the most, let's say, interesting thing. That's the moment of truth. We can see that this hidden dependency had a new deployment. And immediately after, this application, the hidden dependency, had an issue, and then my application had an issue. So I can, you know, say from here that most probably these two applications are related, and this particular problem broke this. So I can click here, and I can start, you know, with a cluster. I think it's just a new release, okay. And then here, and I have named, you know, the commit, oops, because that's the problem. Somebody made a code change, where in this particular case, in order, you know, to emulate the error, I have changed the liveness check of the application. If you are familiar with liveness checks for the application, and I made it fail. That's just an example here. You know, I might see something that is interesting to me. So at the very least, I know now that this commit was the problem. I might, you know, say that, okay, maybe I'm not responsible for this application, so I know who I need to wake up. And I have, again, all the information. So I can verify, for example, that the deployment itself was fine. This was a runtime error. So if we go back with the same way to Codefresh, this is a similar deployment. As far as, you know, the code was concerned, everything was okay. The problem is on runtime because the Kubernetes is not passing the liveness check. So I found all this, and you see, I didn't have, you know, to look at metrics. I decided what information I want to look, and I had this idea of drilling down. So I started from the general case, looking at my application, then I moved to the particular time frame, and then I started looking at dependencies. And at all times, and I think this is, you know, important for me, I only looked at what I was interested in, instead of, you know, opening metrics and looking at everything. So this was just a very simple scenario for Commodore and why I think it's important. I want to stress out that this is a subset, you know, of the capabilities of Commodore. ETL will talk about more for this in details. So that was the demo. And then maybe ETL can share his screen and talk about the meat stuff. I hope this was interesting for you.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Kostis. Thank you very much. Do we have like any questions before we get started? Just so I can see like and maybe answer. Like, first of all, it was really a great explanation on the product, Kostis. I'm not sure if I can outperform you, to be honest, even it is Commodore, but I will try my best. So I think that I'm going to show like a little bit on the questions. So we have, can I see the status of faulty poles and the related events? So let me do like a screen share.
Yeah, you can share that. I think this was the new feature that you added. So people are asking for the new features. Yeah.
No, like I will say that Commodore started by giving like a high level overview, but we see more and more users basically trying to use Commodore to finish your troubleshooting cycle. So they go into Commodore because we notify them that they have a problem, and then they do the deep dive inside Commodore, basically understanding what is the issue. And a lot of the times they can even know how to remediate from within Commodore. So let me do like a screen sharing of Commodore, like on top of Commodore, basically. So here we have like the main Commodore screen, as Kostis showed us. And then to close all tabs so you can see it fresh. I can see the brain consumer PG is currently unhealthy, and I can go and I can see that this service in particular had a lot of issues over like the last 24 hours. More than that, I can see that not only did the service was unhealthy, it also had Datadog issues. So because Commodore integrates with your existing tools, with your existing workflows, you can have like a full picture of everything in one single place. I will answer like the first question about the GitHub commits directly, and would it be possible to use Bitbucket? So yeah, I'm going to show here. Here you have like a real live example of, you can see the commits directly from within Commodore, and you can go to GitHub basically to better understand what is changing in GitHub, what interesting files has changed in GitHub, all within Commodore. I will say that we also support like Bitbucket, GitLab, and Azure repos. So pretty much all of the main Git providers. So I'm going to say that I answered this part live. Let's see if we can also see like live status of pods from within Komodor. I see that some of our pods are having like crash loop back off. One second, I'm having like a technical issues here. So apologize for that. One second.
I think we can answer this question that, you know, one of the latest features that Komodor added was exactly this, to get a live view of the pods and the logs. So if you want to do it from Komodor, yes, you can do it.
Yeah, here you can really see like everything, the change for these specific pods. Basically, you can get the full history and timeline of the pods from within Komodor. So you don't need to go and do like the kubectl describes or get logs. You can get everything you need from a single place very easily. So I will say that like a lot of our users really like this feature in particular because this it saves them the time. And if you have multi-cluster system and maybe God forbid them like multi-cloud, multi-clusters, then because Komodor is cloud agnostic, you can see everything or like every interesting thing in one single place. And you can see really see like difference from within like the GitHub and GitLab difference and the replicas or like any other info changes from within Kubernetes itself. I'm going to do like another like very small like deep dive on the new like events view. This part in particular is super interesting because it lets you see everything that changed from all of your cluster all in one single place. So you can see health event, you can see deployments, you can see alert, you can see everything that happened in your system in one single place. And you can also have like predefined filters. So you can basically answer the question, okay, I get the fact that I'm having an issue, but our other services are also faulty. Maybe I have this issue across clusters, so maybe something in the DB or something else. So this view in particular is very useful for people who try to troubleshoot like more complex issues than like a single service that is currently down. And I can also do like a drill down and to use like the Komodor filters to better understand, I don't know, like show me all of the files on a default cluster from the data team. And I can see that the JSON file changed. So maybe those ones are like interesting changes. So this is another very cool feature in Komodor. I will say about the notification, we didn't really talk about it, but Komodor can allow you to know both about deployments and unhealthy status. And the cool thing about this feature in particular is that you configure it via Kubernetes annotation, meaning you can understand, you can like have each team basically sending it to the right Slack channel without you needing to configure things in the UI, even that you basically, to be honest, you can do it, but it's very like infra's code, writing it down as part of the Kubernetes YAML itself. Okay, I talked about like, I think all of the big features that I want to cover. Kostis, can you share the slide again, just to make sure I didn't miss anything? Yeah, so I think we talk about like all of those. The only thing I didn't say about like setting up Komodor and the integration, I think it is worth mentioning that the installation is super easy and super smooth, meaning like after around like 20 seconds, you can have Komodor installed in your clusters and to give you the power to troubleshoot without the need to worry about like access, multi-cluster, kubectl, kubectl, and so on. So the installation is very easy and we have native integration with all of the big monitoring tools, all of the source provider and so on. So once you go into Komodor, you can have all of this view, all of this timeline for like everything that happened in your system in a couple of seconds. And I think like a lot of our customers are really surprised by how easy it is to enable Komodor and basically to use it. So I think it's one of the coolest things that we have.
I also want to mention something specifically about the GitHub integration, which I think is important, especially for people, you know, that follow GitOps. We're not going to talk about GitOps today, but usually when there is a deployment, Sometimes there is a change in the manifest, so it's a configuration change. Sometimes there is a change in the code, the application source code. And of course, there are cases where you have both. And most systems right now, they have, you know, a specific audience in mind and they focus only one or the other. For example, if you use Argo CD, which is a good example, you change something, it only shows you the manifest. It doesn't know anything about the application. But because Commodore has this, you know, smart GitHub integration, it can actually show you both parts of the same thing. So you can see what changed in the manifest, if there is a change in the manifest, what changed in the cluster, and what was changed in the application, which for me, I think is especially as a developer, because maybe if you're an operator, you're not concerned about, you know, application source code. But if you're a developer, it's super helpful to see like the whole picture and understand everything, both for configuration and for source code.
Yeah, totally. I like a great point. And I will say that one of the nice thing about Commodore is we help bridge the gap. We give a lot of value both for the operation people that are basically like troubleshooting every day and basically like trying to understand what is happening, but also for the developer themselves who want to know about the logs, want to understand how the source code has changed. So we see ourselves as some bridge that help like basically bridge between like the ops people and the developers. And I think it's super valuable. Another question that we got is, where do we store the data? Commodore is a SaaS solution, so we store the data ourselves. We save each one of the events and are usually, we store the data for 3 months like as a default. So this is regarding this sensor. Yeah, we talked about the events view, right? I showed you like the live demo.
Does Commodore show config map changes?
Yeah, we show config map changes. You can also enable us to show secrets themselves. So basically everything that changed, we are now adding node changes. I know for like the ops people in the crowd, it's super useful to know about issues in nodes or like new nodes or bad nodes. So we take this feedback that we got from, again, from customers and specifically ops people to understand not only the application level changes, but the info changes. How did the cluster change, the Kubernetes cluster change, the node pool change? And we are now adding support for this as well. So you can know, oh, I have an unhealthy pod, but now I can see in Commodore that the reason is that the underlying node is unhealthy. Instead of trying to like figure out what is happening and why I have half of my services are alive and the other half is basically unhealthy.
Yeah, I think this was also, you know, part of my demo where I actually went from the command line and did the kubectl command, and Commodore, you know, saw this as a generic event where most other deployment systems would know nothing about manual changes. And I'm not saying it's good, you know, to make manual changes in the cluster. You should not make it. But if this happens, you know, Commodore is smart enough to understand it.
Yeah, the cool thing is because we listen to the kube API directly, like to the control plane, you can't hide anything from us. Once you submit a request to Kubernetes, Commodore will track it and will show it. So you can see like manual changes and like GitHub or like CI/CD changes all in one place. And you can usually see like the one bad, I don't know, commit or change between all of the CI/CD changes, like an important fix or an issue or something else.
And then we have a question about Microsoft Teams.
Yeah, we support Slack and Microsoft Teams. So we support everything. We have a lot of like Microsoft Jobs customers.
I think we answered all the questions so far.
Yeah, we got all the questions live. ETL, is there anything else you want to show us?
Nothing else I want to show. I will say like that we have the nodes coming up real soon, and I think it's going to be a very helpful thing. We know that troubleshooting nodes issues is particularly tricky, and we are going to solve this in particular in the upcoming few weeks. It's also important to say that like we have a free trial, so it's very like easy to use. I think I will say it like on the next slide as well, but just a reminder.
I was actually looking for this, like my point earlier, that this part shows what changed in the cluster, so in the configuration. So if you had installed, you know, Argo CD, you could also get like a similar thing. While this part is application code straight from GitHub. So this, you know, idea that developers are really happy that they have the full idea of both source code changes and manifest changes at the same time, which at least for me is super, super important.
Yeah, I another thing I forgot to mention is we also integrate with your existing configuration and feature flag tools. So if you have launched darkly, if you do manual changes and you always miss the place to see both like manual changes, feature flag configuration, the change over the DB and your like regular CI/CD flow, in Commodore, you can view everything on one single timeline. Basically, and I need to know, oh, I see that the Datadog alert just got started before or after, like after a launch darkly change. So I know those kind of changes can be especially tricky to find out. And we give you this kind of visibility, basically everything in one single place. Yeah, so we answered.
Do you want to share anything about what the future holds for Commodore? You're working on?
Yeah, like I talked about the nodes. We have something even more unique coming up in the near future. And we got the request from a lot of our customers because we know Kubernetes, because we know how to troubleshoot, to help them go once they have an issue, to allow them to understand basically where to look next or what to do next. So our plan for the upcoming like few months, it's still like a very, very early on, but we do have like a couple of alpha users to this, is the ability to automate parts of the root cause investigation, basically to do everything you will do once you have an issue, go to the logs, go to the nodes, go to maybe to other external tool, and to give you some very like precise or concise way of understanding everything that is happening that might be related to the issue. So it's like taking troubleshooting to the next level, not only showing you all of the useful information, but giving you like the next step in your troubleshooting in order to save you precious time.
Awesome. I think we're going to end on this note. Sounds like a very bright future for Kubernetes troubleshooting. Thanks everyone for joining us. We're going to share the recording and the deck with you tomorrow or the day after. And thank you, ETL and Kostis.
Kostis, yeah.
Thank you.
Kostis is the main man here. And we thank you for joining us. And thank you for this very illuminating webinar, even for me. I learned a lot of new things today. So thank you, guys. And see you next time.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye.